MSI X670E Gaming Plus WIFI motherboard. Included in the box, you're going to get a quick start guide. It does not include a paper manual. It comes with two SATA cables, M.2 clips, which is a custom design for this board and MSI, where it's easier to use than just standard screws. It comes with cable stickers, which are cute, but I'm not sure are necessary, and a WIFI antenna. And that antenna is magnetic, so you can easily hook it wherever you want on your case. Handling the motherboard, it's very, very heavy, at least to what I've tried before. Feels high quality. The color scheme seems fine. You've got the black, silver, teal, and gray mix. I think it looks decent, not anything special. I don't know if I would really call it a gaming motherboard, but yeah, I think it's fine. The back panel is fully integrated, which is nice to see. You don't have to mess around with that or lose it potentially in the future. And it does have a metal backplate for the CPU. The configuration does matter with motherboards because some specifications will change based on what your CPU is, what your RAM is. In my case, I'm using a 9900X CPU. I also have Patriot Viper Venom DDR5, 64GB over two sticks with AMD Expo and XMP settings embedded into it. If you have an 8000G type CPU, you will have some limitations for your main PCIe port on 8000 series CPUs, specifically the 700, 600, and 400. It's PCIe 4 8X instead of PCIe 5 16X for 7000 and 9000 series AMD CPUs. With the 8500 and 300 CPU, it goes down even more to PCIe version 4x4. So that's a pretty big limitation. You might actually see some difference in GPU performance. The second M.2 slot also has some potential limitations based on the CPU. 8500 and 300 goes down to PCIe 4x2. However, all of the other CPUs should give you PCIe 4x4. Also keep in mind that some functionality goes directly to the CPU and others go through the two chipsets on this motherboard. There are lower spec chipsets you can consider, the 600 series, or you can even go up to the 800 series ones. The X670E is pretty comparable to the X870E, which is more recent. However, USB 4 support is optional, and this motherboard does not have USB 4. If you specifically want that feature, it's most likely good to go up to the X870E motherboards. So if you do want to potentially save some money, the X670E motherboards are a good option, like this one. The first PCIe port goes directly to the CPU that can be up to version 5 X16, again, depending on your CPU that you're using. For the other PCIe ports, those come from the chipset. The first one is version 3 1X, and that's specifically sized to 1X. And then you have two 16X sized connectors, but they're actually different data transmission amounts. For one of them is a PCIe version 3 1X, however, it is 16X sized. So you can put larger cards in there, but you're only going to get 1X speeds at version 3. And the port on the bottom is PCIe version 4x4. So if you want the most speed from a secondary port, you're going to use the bottom one. The motherboard does have two display connection points depending on if your CPU supports video. You've got HDMI 2.1, 4K at 60 Hz, and DisplayPort 1.4. There are four M.2 slots on the motherboard, so that's a good amount. For the main port, you've got Gen 5 support at X4, up to 128 gigabits per second. The additional M.2 slots are Gen 4x4, up to 64 gigabits per second. With all of those M.2 slots, they do have heat sinks. The heat sinks have thermal pads pre-attached to them. You're just going to take off the little plastic piece before you install your M.2 drive. You also have four SATA ports, which are 6 gigabits per second. You do have four different ports on the motherboard to power RGB LEDs and all of that good stuff. You have two 5-volt ports and two 12-volt ports, and they have different specifications. I'm personally not familiar with all of that functionality and how it works, but know that they're in there. With the X670E chipset type motherboards, you're going to have a lot of connectivity. On the back panel here, we have quite a bit to go over. There's a BIOS flash button that you'll press in combination with one of the USB ports, specifically number 4. We've got the two display connections and then two red USB ports, which are USB 3.2 Gen 2 10 gigabits per second type A. There are three USB 3.2 Gen 2 10 gigabit per second type A ports. And then next to those three, you've got the one that is the flash BIOS port, and that has the same spec. You have four USB 2 type A ports, and those go from the chipset. 2.5 gigabits per second LAN port, a USB 3.2 Gen 2 10 gigabits per second type A port from the chipset, that's red. The one USB-C port, which is 3.2 Gen 2x2 for a total of 20 gigabits per second. That comes from the chipset. You have your two Wi-Fi antenna ports and audio connections. There also is a good amount of USB in the form of headers on the motherboard. You can break those out into back panel ports. In my case, I'm using a multi-memory card reader that connects to one of the USB headers. There's a USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C header. There are two USB 3.2 Gen 1 header connectors. There are also two USB 2.0 headers. With the Wi-Fi connectivity, it supports 6E, and it also has Bluetooth 5.3 support. I did try both the Wi-Fi and the Bluetooth out. With the Wi-Fi, my current router does not have that level of support, but it worked fine. It was actually faster than my wired connection because I'm using a power line networking setup. With the Bluetooth, I tried a PS4 controller, no issues, very easy to connect, as well as a Xbox Series X controller. Again, very easy to connect with Bluetooth. It's super convenient to have those wireless functions on a standard ATX motherboard. There is built-in audio from a Realtek ALC-897 codec-based setup. I did do some very simple tests trying out the audio with different headsets. It was hard for me to notice a serious difference, but I would say the built-in audio on the motherboard is more bassy than my Moto M2 interface, but I think there is a bit more distortion from the built-in audio compared to my audio interface. I did do two audio recordings with an external recorder and my best headset, which is a Sony MDR-7506. You can listen to that and see if you notice any differences. But that really depends on the recorder's functionality as well. It also has the hybrid graphics functionality, so if you want to try that out, you're going to connect your screens to the motherboard itself and not the GPU that you have in there, and then set that hybrid graphics function in the BIOS. I didn't try that out, but know that it at least is an option if you want to look into it. With the storage, there is the ability to do RAID or just standard single drives. I haven't tried out the RAID, but you should be able to get RAID 0, 1, and 10 for the SATA drives. And for the M.2s, you can get RAID 0 or 1. This motherboard does have an LED for giving you feedback if there are issues. You can see four different colors. You got red if the CPU has an issue, yellow if the DRAM has an issue, white if the GPU is not detected or there's a problem with that, green if the boot device has an issue or it's not detected. This motherboard has a huge amount of options in the BIOS. I've just barely scratched the surface. I've been going through it, but every single setting you have to do some research on and try to understand what it does, how it works. You've got a standard easy mode, but if you press F7 or click the advanced button, you'll get a lot more options. If you like overclocking, if you like adjusting your RAM speeds, if you like even underclocking your CPUs and such, you're going to have those options available to you with this motherboard. You can quickly enable AMD Expo or XMP settings with your RAM. In my case, I'm just using the Expo settings, but my RAM supports both, so I could use either one. You can enable or disable SATA hot swap functionality. You have a huge amount of overclocking settings. There's a OC Explorer mode. You can go and adjust the TDP setup. I could adjust it down to 45 watts or jump it up to 170 watts. You also have the precision boost overdrive functionality, but in there you can set thermal points. So if you want to have a limit of how hot your CPU gets, you can do 65, 75, 85 degrees. There's just a huge amount of stuff in there, especially with RAM functionality. There's so many settings, I have no idea what they do. Fan curves, all that. You can easily adjust a lot of things with the motherboard. In my case, having a pretty quiet computer is important. So with the fans, I can do PWM, I can do DC power control. That's super welcome, super functional. I'm going to go over the good and bad of this motherboard based on my opinion. I don't have a lot of experience with recent motherboards, so I can't really compare it to anything else on the market of this chipset or of a similar era of computing. My last PC build was an Intel i7-6700 based setup. That's how long it's been. Let's start with the bad. The visual design is all right, but it's nothing special. It's nothing exciting. I think it's fine. I don't really care too much about the look, but if you do want a specific look, this might not be great for you depending on what you're into. does not have any USB 4 support, so that's 40 gigabits per second potentially. That's kind of a downside for me because I do like USB functionality, but even so, the 20 gigabits per second USB-C port's pretty quick. As I mentioned before, some of the lower PCIe slots have actual smaller data lanes than the size that they are physically, so I think it's convenient, but they're just not going to go as fast as you might expect. This is more of a platform thing than a motherboard specific thing, but if you do want to use 4 sticks of RAM, you're going to have speed limitations right now with the current CPUs and current BIOS. For 2 DIMM per channel, 2 rank sticks, it's up to 5,400 megatransfers per second. So I do think it's best to buy whatever capacity you want in 2 sticks if at all possible. There is no paper manual. Manuals a lot of the time are kind of garbage, but in the case of motherboards specifically, it is nice having a paper manual. So that's sad to see. The stickers are cute, but they feel unnecessary. I'd rather they put a little bit of extra money into the motherboard or maybe a paper manual instead. MSI offers a lot of software. If they were to put that money in development of all that software, like AI stuff, I'd rather see them put that into the motherboards themselves, the actual components used. It just would be nice to get more actual value instead of software value that doesn't really seem like value. The CPU power connector location seems a little awkward with my specific power supply. I did make it work, it does function, but I had to loop it and set it up in a way that just didn't feel amazing. I don't know if it's specific to this motherboard or just like the standard location of that power connector, or in this case, the 2 power connectors, but feels a little awkward. There are 4 SATA ports. I know those are kind of going away. Seems fine to me, but sometimes if you want more SATA connectivity, just know that there's only 4 ports on this one. Now for what I consider good with this motherboard. I've had really good success with MSI products in the past. My previous motherboard, again, that Intel i7-6700 build, has an MSI motherboard that's been super reliable. Before that motherboard, I had a ASRock one, and I had issues with it. I eventually got to the point where it was non-functional, got the MSI board. It's worked with no problems since then. So it's just my personal experience, but MSI products feel high quality in comparison to a lot of the other stuff I've used. The X670E chipset in this motherboard feels like a good mix of price and functionality compared to the more recent stuff, the 800 series ones. The only thing you're specifically losing in this case is USB 4. Having the built-in wireless functionality could be very useful, especially with controllers or if you don't want to run hard wires to get network functionality. It's nice to have that built in with the Wi-Fi. The antenna has a magnet on it, so it's easy to place. It's not going to move around. There have been multiple BIOS updates for this motherboard, which seems like MSI gives it a good amount of support. With AM5, you expect this to have a long lifespan, so hopefully MSI keeps it well updated. All 4 M.2 slots have heat sinks pre-installed with thermal pads. The VRM, MOSFETs, and chokes also have heat sinks. Even though 2 of the PCIe ports are 16x with smaller data sizes, I think it's fine. I like the larger ports even though they don't support the full length speeds. I am using this motherboard with Windows 11, so it does have the TPM support. Obviously, the AMD 9000 series CPUs are also supported with Windows 11, so it's fully current in that respect. There is a lot to this motherboard. So far, I really like it. It's been very functional, very reliable, no issues. I like the huge amount of configurability. It has a good amount of heat sinks and things like that. No complaints. Again, that was a look at the MSI X670E Gaming Plus Wi-Fi motherboard. Hope you enjoyed the video. Scott of Tech, I suppose. See ya.